I will try, okay, I will describe something which is not new. Okay, this was done, okay, I don't know exactly, 15, 20 years ago. This is a work, a joint work with Pierre Williams. Okay, and you have a chance because it was never published. So, not because it's not a good work, it's, in my opinion, an excellent work, but just because I never read the manuscript that Pierre-Louis wrote, and so, at the end, it was not published. Okay, the idea and the techniques are relatively simple. Relatively simple, that means that okay, you know, something is simple for somebody when he knows very well the topics. What we need here is more or less few things. Sobolev spaces, okay, but usual Sobolev spaces. Variational formulation of elliptic partial differential equations. Truncation and superposition of type of Nemitzky operators, and that more or less all, okay? So I hope that you, okay, I hope that I will be able to explain what we did. Okay, so I will begin putting that. Okay, so what is the problem? The problem is the following. I would like to solve the following problem. I'm looking for U. This is the unknown. And U is a function from omega into R, more or less, actually in R bar, because it can take infinite values in some sense, which solve minus divergence of A of X gradient U equals F of X in omega and U equals 0 on the omega. Okay, so here I will write all the hypotheses I need. So I will begin with omega. Okay, I will write that here. Omega is included in Rn. Omega is bound, is open and bounded. Open is essential. Bounded, okay, you can make the unbounded case, but if you don't understand the bounded case, okay, it's a little bit more complicated. Then, okay, so you know omega. Now A is a matrix with L infinity coefficient. So this is an N by N matrix with L infinity coefficient, as I said. And A is elliptic in the sense that there exists an alpha. This is for almost everywhere in omega. And alpha is non-negative. So by that, I mean that the quadratic form, okay, if you prefer, the sum here of A, ij of x, xi A, xi j, is greater than the sum of xi I square. This is for every xi in Rn, or more exactly, almost everywhere in omega, and for every xi in Rn. Okay, so this is the usual ellipticity. So the model, of course, is such a case where A is the identity matrix, and in the case of identity matrix, this is just Laplace equation. Okay, so Laplace equation with L infinity coefficients, and here zero boundary value. Okay, so everything is known about that, except something. I didn't precise where is f. F will be a function in L1 of omega. Okay, so this is my problem. Actually, I will first describe a little bit this problem, then pass to the nonlinear case, but wait for a second. Okay, so so what is the problem? Okay, of course, you know, I was a student of Jacques-Louis Lyons, and for me, this type of problem takes place in a Sobolev space. Okay, so there is a Sobolev space which is called each one zero of omega, and I think that everybody knows what it is. Okay, sometimes it is called W12 zero of omega. This means that this is the completion of the function C infinity with compact support, okay, in the space each one, which is also W12. I forgot to say that omega has no regularity, can have no regularity. This can be a ball, it's okay, but this can be every open set. Okay, so usually when you look at this problem, the variational formulation is to look for U, okay, U in each one zero of omega, and the integral over omega of A of X gradient U gradient V equals FV for every V in each one zero of omega. Okay, let me say that this is when, if F is H minus one of omega, which is nothing but a dual space of each one zero. Okay, so here this is each minus one of omega, each one zero of omega, and so I will put here that out for just 1 minute. If F is an element of the dual of each one zero, then solving this problem for me is to solve this problem. Okay? To look at some U in the space each one zero of omega, such that for every function in the same space of test functions, okay, this equation is solved in weak sets. Okay, this is nowadays, I guess, a very standard formulation, and there is a unique solution of this problem. Okay, due to Lax-Milgram lemma, and to the fact that I will equip the norm as a norm. Okay, I will equip the space each one zero with the norm of V in each one zero is the gradient of V in L2 of omega to the power n when V is in each one zero. So I will keep that. Okay, so for the moment, I forgot about that. And this is for me the standard framework in which I want to solve the problem. Okay? As I said, Lax-Milgram lemma tell us that there is a unique, okay, there is some U solution of this problem. This U is unique, and the application which from F in each minus one of omega gives U in each one zero of omega is a continuous linear application. Okay, so perfect. This is the standard theory. But now I would like to pass to something else. I would like to take F in L1. Okay, this will be the novelty in the problem. Okay, there is an easy case, and the easy case is a case where the dimension is 1. Because when the dimension is 1, L1 of omega is a subspace of H minus 1 of omega. So for n equal 1, okay, I just return to that. So for that reason, I will assume here that n is more than 2. If n is more than 2, okay, then L1 is no more an element. Okay, I mean, there exist functions in L1 which are not elements of H minus 1. So I can no more solve this problem in the problem in this sense. So I have to introduce something new which will replace this setting. And I would like to have a setting in which a new setting in which I will have existence, uniqueness, and continuity in some sense, naturally not in this sense, okay, but in another sense. Okay, and this is what I will do. And I will immediately attack with a non-linear corresponding problem. Okay, no, I will explain what is the result in the linear case, and then I will pass to the non-linear case, okay? So what I will say is the following thing. Okay, so from now on, I keep all the hypotheses which are here. Okay. Oops. And I keep also this one. So this is no more covered by this setting. Okay, and I introduce, I will say what is the solution of my problem. Okay, so I will say that definition. Sorry, I will go here. Ah, okay, bad, as usual. Okay, so definition. U is a renormalized solution of problem one. Okay, so I will call that 1. And this, I will call that the weak formulation. The usual weak formulation. Okay, I will say that U is a renormalized solution, so no more a weak solution. If we have U is a function from omega into R bar, which is measurable, and finite almost everywhere. Okay? So you can tell me, if you have a measurable function which is finite almost everywhere, it has values in R. Okay, yes, but okay. I will discuss that in a moment, why I insist about that. Okay, and I will assume that, okay, so this is the first point. The second point is that tk of u is in each one zero for every k strictly positive. Okay. Problem, what is tk of u? Okay, tk is a following function. Tk is a function from R into R, which is defined like that. This is between k and minus k, this is identity, and then this is plus k or minus k. So this is a continuous function. Tk of u, u is measurable. Tk of u is a measurable function. And this function is in L infinity because tk is bounded. Okay? So this function, which is in L infinity, is correctly defined from the first line. And I ask this function to belong to each one zero. Why not? Okay, this definition, okay, when you consider a mathematical problem, you have the choice of what you want to do. And you have the choice of the definition. This is my definition. Okay, not my definition. This is our definition. And okay, the only thing I have to do is to present a definition which allows me to do something, because I can't give any definition, but then I will prove some theorem. Okay, so first point, this function is in each one zero, and this space is the same space as this one. Okay, so I'm really ambientated in the Sobolev spaces, usual Sobolev spaces. Then I will assume that 1 over kappa, the integral of gradient t kappa of u squared over omega, this tends to zero as k tends to plus infinity. Okay, I will explain why. Okay, this is essential. Okay, and I will return to that. So this is the space where the function is living. Okay, this was the space in this the weak formulation where the function was living. This is now the space where the function will live. Okay. There is already a comment to be done, is the fact that even if the problem here is linear, this is not a vectorial space in general. Okay, I don't know, but okay, I'm sure it is not a vectorial space. Okay, but who cares? Okay, I don't care. And now I have to express.
Why it's not vector space?
Okay, prove it that this is a vector space.
So you need the fact that sum of two, like basically, multiplication by constant should work because you cannot keep everything.
Okay.
So divide k by the same constant. The problem only might be with
tk of lambda u equal lambda tk of u? The answer is no.
No, this is not, but it should be equal to something lambda k over lambda u or lambda u should change.
Okay, but any case.
It's not correct, yes.
Okay, it's not correct, but tk of u1 plus u2.
Yeah, this is there are much more problems. Yes.
Okay, so. Okay, if you can prove it is a vectorial space, I am happy to look at the proof. Okay, any case, I don't care. I don't need that. Okay, I say
my
this.
My question was, is it a complete space?
I don't care neither. Okay? I don't care neither. I say this is a space. This is a set of functions. And this set of function will be sufficient for what I have to do. Okay, and I will explain. Now, I have to write something which is like that, and I will write that now. So I will assume that, that for every v in each one zero of omega intersected with L infinity of omega, for every h, a function from R into R, which is incisible with compact support in R, and each is piecewise C1. Okay? So, example, this type of function. Okay? But this function has not a compact support. Okay? But this type of function, you go back here. Okay? So, a function which is piecewise C1, continuous, of course, and which has compact support. Okay, I will ask that A, gradient of U, gradient of V, H of U, plus A, this is over omega, A, gradient of U, gradient of U, H prime of U, V, is equal to F, H of U, V. Or, if you prefer, in other terms, or equivalently, minus divergence of A of X okay. Stop. Okay, I will go back to that later, but maybe. Okay, and this will be the equation. Okay, so it's clear what I did. I didn't use V as test function in the equation. I used V H of U as test function in the equation. Okay? Again, this is my choice, okay, our choice of definition of the equation. Okay, when you make such a choice, you have to first to be sure that this has a meaning. Okay, so let me look at the term one by one and show you that the term have a meaning. Okay, here V, okay, F is in L1, V is in L infinity, and H has compact support. So H will go from R into R and as compact support is in L infinity. So this function here is measurable as a superposition of a measurable function by a continuous function. Okay? And this is bounded, so this is L infinity. This is L infinity, and this is L1. So at least right-hand side has a meaning. Okay? Let me now turn to this function here. This is not correctly written. Okay? This is not correctly written because, okay, I don't know what is gradient U. I never mention the existence of some gradient U. Okay? So, but what I can say is the following, is that H has a compact support. So I can imagine that for some K equals K of the function H, it depends on the function F, the support of H is included in minus K plus K. Okay? And here, you know, where U is bigger than K, there is no, this is zero. Okay, if this has a meaning. So what I will do here is here to put tk of u. And if I do that, formally, this is the same thing. Okay? Of course, the first thing that I wrote has no sense, but this has this now has a meaning. A is in L infinity. This is in L2 due to that. This is in L2. And this is a function in L infinity, so this is in L1. And I will make the same convention that here I will replace that gradient by gradient tk of u, gradient tk of u. Okay? So this has a meaning. Okay, what I wrote before had no meaning because I didn't know what is gradient of u. actually you can define gradient of U, but I will do that later. But here, in this space, which is not a vectorial space, but a set of functions, in this set of functions, this has a meaning. And I will say that U is a renormalized solution of this problem if U satisfies that it belongs to this space with the equation written in this sense. Okay? This is the definition. And I will give the following results. Theorem 1. There exists, okay, for every f given in L1 of omega, there exists at least one renormalized solution. Theorem 2. The renormalized solution is unique. There is uniqueness of the solution. And third, theorem third. Okay, so that will be the following one. If Fn is in L1 of omega, F is in L1 of omega, Fn tends to F in L1 of omega, say strongly, then for every k strictly positive, tk of un tends to tk of u, each one zero of omega strongly. Okay, and moreover, we will see in the proof that there is something which is similar to that. Okay, I mean that those things converge uniformly to zero in n. Okay? So I will call not n, but epsilon. But epsilon is in a sequence. Okay, so this is a good setting, okay, in my opinion, if I am able to prove those three theorems, which say that, first of all, the problem has a solution. Second, the solution is unique. And then there is some continuity of the solution with respect to the variable, okay, in the sense that the tk converge strongly in each one zero when the f epsilon converge in L1 strongly, and here I will add, or weakly. Okay? So weakly is sufficient. But be careful, this is weakly in L1, which is stronger than to converge in the weak sense, in the weak star sense of measures. I will return to that. Okay, so this is a setting. Those are the results. Okay, and now I will make a few comments and then pass to the nonlinear case. The nonlinear case will be exactly the same, except Laplace operator with L infinity coefficient will be replaced by P Laplace operator with L infinity coefficient. Okay? But this will be essentially the same thing. Okay, so So let me make a few comments. And the first comment I would like to do is...
Excuse me, and this mapping from F to the solution is
Did I say that?
No, but this is a question.
Yes. Okay.
So
okay, good question. Okay, once you know that a solution exists and is unique, okay, and some other and this property, you can see that actually the application is linear. The application is linear because, okay, you make approximation of f by f epsilon, okay, at the epsilon level, f epsilon which are in each minus one, say in L infinity, for example. You are linear at the level of epsilon, you pass to the limit, yeah. And you have the linearity.
So finally, actually, you have some...
Okay, finally, the application f gives you is linear, but f gives t kappa of u is nonlinear. Okay, it's strange. Okay, it's not so clear. I agree. Okay, so. Okay, thank you, Alexander. So let me give an example, and the example will be out of this framework. But let me consider the following problem. Minus delta u equals the Dirac mass. Okay, say in a ball, the ball of center zero and radius r, and u equals zero on the boundary of the ball. Okay, so you know this is the Laplace problem. Here, there is a big difference, actually. The big difference is that delta zero is not in L1, but delta zero is a measure, okay? And this changes completely the things, but this is an illustration of what I would like to do. So you know that the solution is something like u equals a constant over x to the n minus 2 minus the same constant over r n minus 2. Okay, for n more than 3, and if not, you replace that by a logarithm. Okay, so if I draw a picture of that, the function u is like that. This is r. And clearly, this function has an infinite value. Okay? Of course, you can say this function is almost everywhere finite. That's sure. But there is no doubt that this function tends to infinity in zero. So this is why, I insist on r bar here. Okay? By the way, all the difficulty to pass from the case of L1 to the case of measure, we did something about the measure, but for the measure, the results are not as complete as they are here. Okay, they are complete in the linear case, and I will return to that. But in the non-linear case, the situation is still unknown due to the fact that we do not know if there is uniqueness or not in the nonlinear case. Okay, so if you look at that, the function is clearly measurable, is finite almost everywhere, and when you cut the function here at 8k, of course the function is here, this is a C1 function, then this is a constant function, a C1 function. So this is clearly a function which is actually Lipschitz continuous, okay? But with a Lipschitz continuity which depends on k, of course. So this is okay. And when you look at that, this is no more true. This is no more true that this tends to zero. Actually, this tends to a constant for this solution. So this explains, in some sense, why measures are not L1 functions. Okay, this explains. This is due to that fact. Okay? So this was a small illustration, and now I have finished for the moment. I will return probably at the end of the second lesson to the linear case to say that there is another formulation which is an excellent formulation, which is a formulation by transposition due to Stampaca, but which works only in the linear case. So now I pass to the nonlinear case. Okay, so for the nonlinear case, Ça c'est le bordel. Okay, sorry. Okay, for the nonlinear case, this is still joint work with Pierre-Louis, and I will again work with a function which goes from omega into R, which satisfies minus divergence of A of X gradient U equals F in omega, and U equals zero on the omega, and I will explain all of the things. Okay, first of all, let me tell you something that if you do not like, only Dirichlet boundary condition, you like Neumann boundary condition or mixed condition or Fourier condition, you can do it. You can do it. Of course, if you have pure Neumann boundary condition, you will have a condition that the integral of f should be zero, But except of that, the boundary condition does not play a prominent role here. What plays a prominent role in this setting and also in the nonlinear setting is the fact that we are with second order operators and with scalar equations. I now realize that I forgot to say something extremely important. Concerning the equation. So I go back for a few minutes to the linear case. Of course, this is all what I say is valid also in the nonlinear case. The linear case is just here to be sure that you can follow easily, because if you don't like nonlinear case, you will take p equals 2 and this equation is this one. So even if you don't like monotone operators, you can follow thinking to the linear case. The linear case is a model of what I would do. Okay, so let me return for a moment to this equation. This equation is to write actually the equation against a test function which is a product of a usual test function by a function of the solution. This looks strange, but actually, you know already that. You know that if you look at Burger's equation or system of conservation law, this is entropy solutions. Why? Because, what is Burger equation? Burger equation is to write that du over dt plus d over dx of f of u equals 0. So the equation is no more a second order, it's a first order equation. And you look, this is a transport equation with a nonlinearity here. So u goes from omega times 0 t into r, or r bar, but in r here. And f is a function from r into r, which is, say, c1 or something like that. Okay? And when you look at equation of this type, you know, okay, it's very well known, that if you look at this equation just in the sense of distribution, you have plenty of solutions. Okay? You have plenty of solutions, but if you add an entropy condition, you have only one solution. And what is an entropy condition? This is the fact to make a formal computation that I do now. I write that on the form d dt plus f prime of u du dx equals 0. This has no sense, but if the solution is sufficiently small, this is okay. And I would like to have not only this equation, but also I will multiply that by a function from q of u from r into r. So I will multiply that by q prime. Okay, I will take q in c1. And I multiply the equation formally. This is formally by q prime. Okay, this is nothing but d dt of q of u. And if I define eta, the function from r into r, by eta prime of s equals q prime of s, f prime of s, for every s in R, this is eta prime of u. I enter that in the derivative, and this is d over dx of eta of u equals 0. So I will not. When you look at this type of equation, Burger's equation, you do not look at this equation in the sense of distribution. You look at this equation in the sense of distribution, and you add that this entropy condition is satisfied for every, I don't remember what, for every q which is convex, except that for some strange reason, which is due to the fact that the solution can be discontinuous, this is not equal to 0, but less or equal to 0. So you have the correct setting for Burger's equation for system of conservation law, when one is able to solve them, is to look at a solution in the sense of distribution, but also which also satisfies the entropy condition. Okay, for every q convex. But if you look at that, this is exactly what I did. Because here, what I did was just to write that minus divergence of h of u grad a gradient of u, okay, I forget about theta, plus a of x gradient u h prime of u is equal to f h of u. Okay, if formally I use v as test function in this equation and I integrate by part, this is equivalent to that. For every h, okay, since h is with compact support, it's extremely difficult that it is convex. Okay? But in this computation here, this sign is exactly coming from this part, because if Q is convex, this will be positive, and you will put this on the other side. Okay? So actually, what we do here is some type of entropy solution for elliptic equations, which is strange, but it's not completely new, because entropy solutions were introduced for first order systems.
Excuse me, and do you actually need H in your identity? Isn't it equivalent if I use only truncation? Truncation, of course, has no compact support, but it seems to me that the relation has meaning for if you replace H of U by simply truncation of U with the same K.
Yeah, but truncation has no compact support.
Yeah.
And
isn't it the same?
No, the answer is okay. In my opinion, the answer is no. We will see something which is similar to what you say, but H is not a truncation. H is one. Okay, we will be allowed to take H equal one in some sense, and I will explain why. But let me go. But okay, you.
Yeah, in the case of conservation law, we don't need the entropy relation for all entropies. It is enough to have only for Kruskov entropy, which is a special form of the.
Yeah, you need one strictly convex entropy, and it's okay. Yeah. But okay, but here, yeah, okay, maybe you can do better than I did, okay, I'm sure, and than what Pierre Williams did, okay, do it. And I go now to the nonlinear case, I mean the P. Laplacian type equation. Okay, so actually it will be two differences. Here I will put a right-hand side in divergence form, okay. And so there are two main differences. This is this one, which was not in the previous equation, and this one. So I have to explain what are the hypotheses. So again, omega is included in Rn, and omega is open and bounded. Okay, now I have to describe, okay, I describe here what was A of X. So the model here is A of X Xi equals A of X Xi, okay? This is no more the case, so I will have a function A, which is a function from omega cross Rn into Rn, which is Karateodori, function. That means that for every Xi in Rn fixed, the application X gives A of X Xi is measurable. Okay, so this is in omega, this is in Rn, this is measurable. And almost everywhere in X in Rn, the application Xi in Rn gives A of X Xi in Rn is continuous. Okay, this is the standard hypothesis in such a way that if we look at A of X V of X, say capital V of x, where V is a vector of measurable function. Okay, let me call that L0 of omega to the power n, vector of measurable function. N vector, okay. Of measurable function. This function here is a measurable function. Okay? When you substitute into a Carathéodory function, you get a function which is still measurable. Okay? This is why this continuity condition is made. Okay, this is absolutely standard, but all of we do is absolutely standard, except a few variations. Okay, now I will, so this function is Carathéodory, and I will make three hypotheses. The first hypothesis is that A of x xi times xi is greater than alpha xi to the power p minus a0 of x. This is almost everywhere in x in omega, and for every xi in Rn, where alpha is strictly positive, and a0 is a function in L1 of omega, and say a0 is positive. This is why I said minus a0. Okay, of course, if I look at the model which is here, this is okay. This is exactly the same thing, except now there is some p. So there is, I will ask here that, okay, I am too small to do that. Okay, so I will take a p which is between 1 and plus infinity. So the p is here. So this is the coerciveness that I ask here. Okay? Now I will replace this by a gross condition, which will say that a of x xi absolute value is less than some beta positive times xi to the p minus 1 plus b of x, where b belongs to lp of omega, and b, and b is positive. And I will put the p minus 1 here. Okay, so this is also true with this model, with p equals 2. Here p equals 2. And, okay, since the matrix is in L infinity, this condition is satisfied with b equals to the norm of L in, the matrix A in L infinity, and b equals 0. And I add a further condition which is essential in all this story, that the function is strictly monotone. A of x xi minus a of x eta, xi minus eta, is strictly positive for every eta, and for every xi, and every eta, and almost everywhere in x, of course, with xi different of eta. So the function is strictly monotone. Okay, this is the general setting of monotone operators, say Lorentz style in the French terminology. This was used, okay, this was essentially introduced by Minty, we will hear this name afterwards. So the big name here are Minty, Browder, and Laurel Jones, who developed a theory which depends on also on you. Okay, and there is something missing. I will take some G, which is a vector in LP of omega to the power n. Okay, so this is clearly a generalization of this setting with G equals zero. Okay, so I forget about the linear problem which was here, and I keep this one. Now, I will make a further hypothesis. If I look what I did here, I said that when I look at this type of problem, now I do not care about, I forget about F in L1, and I just look at the classical monotone problem. In the case of the classical monotone problem, what I want to do here is to look, I will write that here, and I will look at U in W1. Okay, so for F in W minus 1 P prime of omega, which is a strange space, but the only interest of this space that this is the dual of W 1 P 0, this is by definition. Okay, for every F, okay, the classical weak formulation, usual, as I said, usual weak formulation is to look at U such that U is in W 1 P 0 of omega. P is a P which intervenes here in the hypothesis here and here. Okay, P was 2 in the linear case, such that integral of A of X gradient U gradient V equals FV for every V in W1P 0 of omega. This is the integral, and this
plus G.
Oh yeah, okay. No, okay, but at the moment, G equals 0. Okay, but G, okay, plus G, okay. Plus G gradient of V integral. Actually, every function of this type can be written as minus divergence of F with F in LP prime of omega to the power n. I hope that I call that P prime. Okay. I play guilty. This is prime here. This is a prime. And 1 over P plus 1 over P prime is equal to 1. So this is the older conjugate exponent of P. So the weak formulation is this one. And there is a classical result due to Minty, Browder, and extended to other cases by Laurel Jones, which says that when F is in W minus 1 P prime, there is a solution of this problem. This solution is unique, and the application F done U gives you is continuous from W minus 1 P prime into W1 P0. Okay? If you know that, it will be easy for you to follow. If you don't know, you just believe me. If you don't believe me, you take P equals to A of X, C equals A of X matrix L infinity elliptic multiplied by C, and you can follow all I will say. In the non-linear case, in the so-called P Laplacian case with L infinity coefficient, this is exactly the Laplacian case with L infinity coefficients. You can do exactly the same. There is one difficulty that we will see in the proof. But essentially, if you are able to do that in the linear case, you are able to do that in the nonlinear case. Okay, let me tell you something else that actually, if you don't know the monotone operator, you will discover in the proof I will do, okay, where is the problem? Okay, you can follow the linear case easily because the linear case is a special case of the monotone case. And you will discover that there is an extra difficulty, and you will discover the way to solve this extra difficulty. And this way of solving the extra difficulty is due to Minty. Okay? Okay, so let me assume that you agree with this case. With this setting, that in the case where there is F is no more in L1, I didn't say that F is in L1 at the moment. If F is in W minus 1 P prime, so of this form, by chance G, this is exactly the divergence of G that I put in my equation. This problem has a unique solution. This solution is unique and it is continuous with respect to the data. Okay, let me tell that G times in LP prime of omega to the n cross W minus 1 P prime gives you in W1P is continuous. Okay, so I want now to look at the case where F is in L1. So this is again the novelty as it was in the linear case, okay? But this novelty is a novelty only when P is less than N. Why? Because when P is more than N, W1P0 of omega is included in C0 alpha of omega, let me call that theta. For theta, a strictly positive number less than 1, so all the functions of W1P0 of omega are Hölder continuous. If they are Hölder continuous, by duality, the measures, or more exactly, the bounded measures on omega, so the measure with finite mass, are included in W1 minus 1 P prime of omega. This is the dual, a consequence of the dual of this inequality. So in particular, L1 is included in this case. So in the case where P is more than N, F in L1 is included in W minus 1 P prime of omega, and there is nothing to prove because the general formulation finished the story. So from now on, I will assume that P is less or equal to N, even if I can continue making, like that, and being blind, and everything will work, more or less. But the real case is the case where p is less or equal to n. Okay, and in this case, I will define what is, okay, so I will keep those hypotheses and I will define what is a solution of the nonlinear problem. Okay, I will say definition that U is a renormalized solution of problem one. Okay, it was conveniently written one. If U is a function from omega into R bar, infinite, possibly infinite value, measurable but which is finite almost everywhere. Okay, now Tk of U is no more in each one zero. Tk of U is in W 1 P 0 of omega. So, in some sense, what I will do and is I will replace 2 by P. The problem is that what should I do when I have 1? Is 1 equals 2 minus 1? Okay, there is a problem. So, basically, I replace 2 by P. Now, here, I will write that. Here, the same thing, I replace the test function by W1P0. H does not move. This is exactly the same setting. And here, I will replace that by A of X and gradient T kappa of U. And here the same. And here I have to add something because I will add plus the integral over omega of g times the gradient of this one. So this will be gradient v h of u plus the integral over omega of g gradient t kappa of u h prime of u v. Okay? So, what did I do? I took V.
Why gradient T kappa?
Okay, just because I used V, each of U as test function. When I integrate by parts, formally, this is a correct formulation. What I will write is not really a correct formulation, but what I want to write is minus divergence g multiplied by h of u v, and I integrate by parts. V is zero at the boundary, so I have the right to write that as g gradient of h of u v. Okay, and this is gradient of V times H of U plus gradient of U, H prime of U, V. Okay, and this is what I wrote. But since, okay, the first one I write like that because this is in LP prime, a vector in LP prime, a vector in LP, an infinity function. And this one, like here, I have g gradient of u, I don't know where it is, but h prime is 0 outside of minus kappa plus kappa, so I replace by gradient t kappa of u, h prime of u, v, and this has a meaning. Okay? Okay. So, you know the formulation in the nonlinear case is exactly the formulation of the linear case, where I have replaced P by 2, and A of x xi by A of x xi. Okay? This is exactly the same thing. Okay, exactly. Okay, there is no news in this story. Okay, and now I can. Okay, so for me, G will be fixed, or okay. If not, I have to add something here. For every G in LP prime of omega to the n. Okay, and I will enter that here, and that here. And here I will add something. So let me begin and write that. Okay, I will prove the following three results. First of one, if I take, so you agree that the formulation is just taking P in place of 2, A of x xi replaced by the nonlinear function. Okay, so the first theorem is for every g in LP prime, vector in LP prime, for every f in L1, there exists at least one renormalized solution of 1. So a function which belongs to this set of functions and which satisfies this equation which has a meaning. Okay? And this is, again, an entropy formulation of a second order, now nonlinear problem. Second theorem, for every G and for every F, there is uniqueness of the renormalized solution. I mean, if I, for G in LP prime, vector in LP prime, and F in L1 given, I have two solutions, U1, okay, U and U hat, then U, two renormalized solutions, then U equals to U hat. Third thing, if F epsilon is in L1, F is in L1, G epsilon is in LP prime to the N, G is in LP prime to the N, F, okay, F epsilon tends to F weakly, strongly in L1 or even weakly. And here I have to add G epsilon tends to G in LP prime of omega strongly. This is strong. This is weak, this is strong. This can be weak, this is strong. Then, the application, okay, then Tk of U epsilon tends to Tk of U, W1 P0 of omega strong. So, here again, we have a problem which has one solution. The solution is unique, and there is some continuity with respect to the data. So this is a problem. If I prove those three theorems, this problem is well posed in the sense of Adamar. And we, okay, I am happy, and I hope you are happy too. Okay? So in other terms, this setting is a convenient setting to solve this type of problem, nonlinear P Laplacian with L infinity coefficients, quote, with right hand side in L1. Okay? So you can say, okay, but here you have weakly, here you have strongly. Okay, you should have weakly here. Okay? Okay, the answer is no. The answer is no because take F equal to zero, it is known that for monotone, nonlinear monotone problems, the weak convergence of the right-hand side does not imply the convergence in any sense of the solutions. Okay? So here, strongly is compulsory. So you can say, okay, but okay. Here you said strongly. If you say strongly here, we are happy. There is something disturbing that we put here weakly. Okay? The answer is the following, that weak convergence in L1 is something which is relatively strong. Okay? More exactly, if you look, okay, look at the case of the linear problem here, and look at the case where f here is weakly convergent in L2. If this is weakly convergent in L2, due to the fact that omega is bounded, this is strongly convergent in h minus 1. So compactness comes from this fact. So here this is more or less the same. The weak convergence in L1 gives you compactness, which is this compactness here. Okay? This is not true, but this is not so false.
Excuse me, and if the weak solution exists, then it must it coincide with the renormalized one?
Okay, good question. This will be my next theorem. Okay.
Because,
okay.
It's exactly the place where the compact support of H can.
Okay, so let me write something that I will use. Okay, consider. Okay, theorem 4. Actually, this is a proposition, if you want, in the order of the importance of the result, but. Okay, if f is in L1 of omega, but also in W minus 1 p prime of omega, this can be the case. Okay, we can define the weak solution and the renormalized solution. Okay, we have that any renormalized solution is a weak solution, and every weak solution is a renormalized solution. Okay? So this is the answer to your question. Okay, and actually, so at least when we are with usual things, we continue to use the usual things. Okay. I will begin proving theorem 1. Okay, I will not do. Okay, I will try to prove all of that in all details. Okay? So to show you that this is not a complicated story. This is just technically at some point a little bit complicated, but okay. If this was so simple, you know, you did it before me. Huh? Okay? So, let me try to do that, and I will, okay, actually, I will tell you what I will do. I will begin proving theorem 1, and I will prove the. Okay, actually, to prove theorem 1, okay, I will do the following. Okay, let me do it. Let me prove theorem 1. But the proof of theorem 1 will be rapidly turned to the proof of some other things. Okay, so. Let me begin, and we will see what we do. Okay, So proof of theorem 1. So what do we do? Okay, you do as usual. When you have a new problem, you go back to an old problem, making an approximation. You make a priori estimate. You pass to the limit. Okay, I will do that. Okay, or more or less, I will do something very similar. So let me take F in L1. Let me take F epsilon, say, somewhere. Okay, for example, in LP prime of omega, such that F epsilon tends to F in L1 of omega strongly. Okay. I know a very good example for that. Omega is bounded. The typical example is to take F epsilon equals T 1 over epsilon of F. I have a function F. The function F is in L1, so it has big things, value close to infinity. I cut everything at K by taking K equals 1 over epsilon. This is a function which is in L infinity, and clearly this F epsilon tends to F. This F epsilon is in L infinity, so in LP prime, and it tends to F in LP prime strongly. In L1 strongly. Okay? By Lebesgue dominated convergence theory. Okay, and now I claim that there exists U epsilon solution of U epsilon is in W1P 0 of omega minus divergence of A of X gradient U epsilon equals F epsilon minus divergence G in D prime of omega. This is a weak formulation, or if you prefer, integral of A. This is exactly equivalent. This one here is exactly equivalent to the fact that A of X gradient U epsilon gradient V is equal to integral of F epsilon V plus G gradient V for every V in W1P 0 of omega. Okay? So there exists, okay, I used what was written here, that for a right-hand side which is in W minus 1P prime, there exists a unique solution of this problem. Okay, I will not prove that, but I ask you to believe that this is true. There exists a solution. And now, I will do two things. Okay, I can continue. I will make something. I will begin the proof and then turn back. I explain. So now I want to make an a priori estimate. So the a priori estimate, you know, what can I do? The usual a priori estimate to solve this problem is to use V equals U epsilon as test function. Okay? If I try V equals U epsilon, I get A of X gradient U epsilon equals F epsilon U epsilon plus G gradient U epsilon. Okay, this is legal. This is okay. I have the right to do that. This is very good because I have coerciveness. So this is greater than alpha gradient U epsilon to the P minus a zero of X, okay, due to this term that I add. This term here is less than G in LP prime, gradient U epsilon in LP, of omega to the n, and I can kill this term, or in French we see eat this term by this one, because here we have a power p and here we have a power 1, and p is strictly more than 1. Okay, so everything is very good, except this term here, where f epsilon is bounded only in L1. So I cannot do anything with this term. So this is impossible. No. I do not do that. I do not do that. Why? Because in order to treat this term, I should put a function which is in L infinity. Okay, but we have a function which is in L infinity. This is tk of u epsilon. Let me go with tk of u epsilon. And actually, this is the first trick of the proof. It works. Okay? So I put here tk of u epsilon, and I write a of x gradient u epsilon, gradient tk of u epsilon equals f epsilon tk of u epsilon plus g epsilon gradient tk of u epsilon. And this is legal, okay? This is allowed to do that, okay? Now, what do I do? Here, I think a little bit, and I think that, okay, you know probably that gradient tk of u epsilon, I will use that in a very repetitive mode. This is the gradient where u epsilon on the set where u epsilon is less or equal to k times the gradient of u epsilon. Okay? Because u epsilon here is in W1p, 0. Okay? So this is a very well-known formula. So here, since this is, I can replace that, multiplying that here, by the characteristic function where u epsilon is less than k. I didn't change anything. But when I have that, I can change this one in gradient tk of u epsilon, the same. Okay, and then I can forget about that because this is already here. Okay, so the first term is a of x gradient tk of u epsilon gradient tk of u epsilon. Okay, same thing as here. This is bigger than alpha gradient tk of u epsilon to the power p. This is less than here. This is, okay, g epsilon, there is no g epsilon in this story. G is already in LP prime, so I do not need to make any approximation. This is less than g in LP prime of omega. But I could have g epsilon the same if I have strong convergence. This is no problem. Gradient t kappa of u epsilon in LP to the power n, and I can eat this term, which is linear in gradient t kappa, by this term, which is power p, p more than 1, okay, by something, by a Young formula, okay, I will get an a priori estimate. And here, what is good here is that this is surely less than f epsilon in L1 multiplied by k. So at the end of the day, okay, I have this a priori estimate. This is okay for every epsilon and for every k. And this is not an a priori estimate for u epsilon. This is an a priori estimate for t kappa of u epsilon. This estimate depends on kappa. But still, I have that gradient t kappa of u epsilon in LP of omega to the n is less than a constant which depends. Okay, let me call that, let me write that like m plus, okay, m times kappa plus m prime, where m and n prime are constant which depends on g in Lp prime and of f epsilon, okay, less than some c star in L1. Okay, so if f epsilon is bounded in L1, if g epsilon was bounded in Lp prime, okay, but this will be the case if I have this type of hypothesis here, then, okay, then I have this a priori estimate, okay, for every k and for every epsilon. So I will be able to extract a subsequence, a diagonal subsequence, such that for every k, say, natural number, t kappa of u epsilon prime tends to some uk, where in w 1 p prime 0 weakly, where uk is an element of w 1 p prime p 0 of omega. Okay? I can do that due to this a priori estimate. And now I will stop because I will say the following. If I continue like that, I will prove the existence. But there is something much more, not easy, but much more smart to do is to say, stop. Let me assume that I have proved theorem 4 and theorem 3. Okay? If I have proved theorem 4 and theorem 3, the result is done. Why? Because the weak solution here, the usual weak solution is actually a renormalized solution. So the u epsilon that I have here, I will prove that, is actually a renormalized solution of the same problem with f epsilon. Okay? And if I have proved that, and second, if I have proved that this theorem of stability is done, okay, this proves that the limit of those approximations, okay, in this sense, tends to t kappa of u w1p strongly, where u is a renormalized solution corresponding to f. Okay, so if I prove theorem 4 and theorem 3, I have proved theorem 1. Yes?
Our time is over for today.
Yeah, that's good. Okay. So let me make one phrase of conclusion. So what I will... Okay. Of course, I can follow this way. But I will have to repeat, to prove this theorem, I will have to repeat the same thing in a setting where u epsilon has more regularity than the regularity which is here. Okay? So this will be... Okay, I have two choices in some sense. Either I go this way and I prove the existence, and I will say, okay, stability is the same thing. Or I prove this theorem, and I get this one. And I consider it's more smart, more wise, to do this theorem first, okay? So I stop here, and next, okay, Saturday, you get the proof of that, and the proof of that.